Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath school lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series is a very challenging one on the Holy Spirit and spirituality. This particular lesson, which is number 4 in that series, is entitled The Personality of the Holy Spirit. It's the lesson for January 28, 2017. And before we open this up, I think we should ask the Holy Spirit to guide us in our thinking. Our kind and loving Father, it's a privilege to learn more about you. We realize that your very nature, your existence, and the natures of Christ and the Holy Spirit are way beyond our human capabilities of understanding, but help us to do our best to try to understand what you have taught us in the Scriptures is our prayer today in Jesus' name. Amen. So what picture comes to your mind when the Holy Spirit is mentioned? You think of a person or some form of divine power or force like a wind or fire?
Radio waves. The Bible.
I think it's not material, so you can't really, even radio waves. The only good thing about radio waves is you can't see them, but it's still in the material realm. Spirit, I think, I look at the spirit as an influence. You can have an evil influence, you can have a good influence. And it's more than that, but I think in practicality, that's a good way to look at it.
Okay, does he have a personality?
What do you mean by personality?
That's what I want to know. We're going to see. We're going to look at that.
So power to think and to do.
Have a personality, you need to be able to think, you need to be able to choose, and you need to be able to speak.
Okay, a computer can do that. Every one of those.
No.
Yes.
Computer cannot choose. It only can choose what you
tell
it.
It can choose.
No, it cannot choose.
Well.
It cannot have any free choice. We're talking about free choices here. Computer has no ability to have free choice.
Okay, I'll give you that. But it's still choosing, even though that you're programming it to take a certain choice,
yeah.
It's still choosing because you put an if condition in, it's going to pick one or the other.
Yeah, that's sort of an artificial kind of choosing. That's not the kind of choosing we're talking about here.
Well, that's what I want you to explain what that is.
Okay, let's go to John 16:13-14. When, however, the Spirit comes who reveals the truth about God, and I think that's a very important passage there. This is one of the main jobs of the Holy Spirit. And for those of us who believe in the great controversy and the battles that are going on between God and the devil and misrepresentations and so forth like that, the Holy Spirit comes to reveal the truth about God. He will lead you into all the truth. He will not speak of his own on his own authority, but he will speak of what he hears and will tell you of things to come. He will give me glory, because it's Jesus speaking, of course, because he will take what I say and tell it to you. All that my Father has is mine. That is why I said that the Spirit will take what I give him and tell it to you. So that sounds like a pretty personal sort of a characteristic.
Then it acts like a telephone.
All that words of him and it is really just comes from the word it. It will do this, it will do that, rather than he will do this. We personified something that really isn't there.
I likened it to a telephone, because if I talk to you, I talk to the telephone, and the telephone tells you what I'm saying.
Are you happy to have the telephone leading you around? Good for you.
Wait a minute. Jim, would you open the door for me? Jesus is the one that's leading, but it's leading through the phone.
Jesus says he will lead you.
Yeah, Jesus
says, not I will lead you, he will lead you.
Well, doesn't that work the same way? Because I just told the phone to say something, and it's telling, the phone is telling.
How about go back to John 14:6? I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. And so it doesn't say, well, by me and my Holy Spirit.
it's just me. We can put the spirit of truth into.
Okay, we go to John 15, 26 and 27. The Helper will come, the Spirit who reveals the truth about God and who comes from the Father. I will send him to you from the Father, and he will speak about me. I don't see how you can say that that's Jesus.
Where did Jesus come from? Where did Jesus come from?
No, that's not the question. The question is...
No,
Jesus
is the question.
No, it isn't. Jesus is right here. He's with his disciples. He's speaking to his disciples.
Where did he come from?
That's not the question.
Yes,
the question,
it is.
No, it isn't. Read what it
Jesus
says.
Jesus said he came from the Father.
Yes.
Jesus came from the Father also.
Of course. That's not the question. The Helper will come. The Spirit who reveals the truth about God who comes from the Father. Okay? So Jesus comes from the Father.
Same place Jesus came from.
But Jesus now says, I will send him to you from the Father, and he will speak about me. And you too will speak about me because you have been with me from the very beginning. Jesus is talking about somebody else who's going to be sent from the Father.
It isn't that easy.
Well,
it isn't that easy.
Scripture, but I'm
not twisting.
Yes, you are.
No, I'm not. I'm not twisting.
Okay, let's go to John 14. Are we willing to accept what it says here? He is the Spirit who reveals the truth about God.
What verse?
This
17.
Is John 14, I'm sorry, 17. 17, and we're going to go from 17 to 26. So we'll do 17 first. He is the Spirit who reveals the truth about God. The world cannot receive him because it cannot see him or know him, but you know him because he remains with you and is in you. Then we go down to 26. The Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and make you remember all that I have told you. So, who is the Helper?
The Spirit of Truth.
Okay.
But we don't need to personify it.
What are some of the characteristics of a person? What would distinguish a person from a force, wind, fire, or power? People have the ability to think, to choose, and to speak, and to express their choices. In these verses, we notice that the Holy Spirit will lead us into all truth. That's 16:14. He will reveal the truth about God and speak about me. He will teach you everything, remind you of all I have told you. Does that sound more like an impersonal force, like wind or fire, or more like the actions of an intelligent being? And you out there can have your choice. Think about all the choices here.
We said earlier that one person can influence the other, at least the infinite one, or Jesus can influence. And the method he uses, or the means with which he uses, is his spirit. Mm-hmm. Do we need another personification or another person, another entity, to do what the Father and the Son are capable of doing?
That's why, and it still works for me.
Yeah.
And my question is...
But you can do he if you want.
The question in my mind is not, do we need it? The question is that what's there? Is that what the Bible describes? It's not a question of whether we need it or whether we don't need it. It's a question of what does the Scripture say?
Well, what is it saying? It's not just what it's...
So we go on down. When it talks about the Holy Spirit, he sends another comforter. And that other comfort is an allos in Greek, meaning another of the same kind. So whatever Jesus was like, the Holy Spirit is like. They're as close as he can make us.
So we don't need a third one.
No, there is a third one. The question is, what kind of person is it?
Well,
like,
you could
like
say...
Michael is like God, but he had the full Godhead dwelt in the...
But Michael is not called an allos. An allos means another one, but the
what,
same kind.
What text are we...
That's, we're talking about John 16:14. I believe.
In verse 13, just above that, no. He will not speak of his own initiative. Whatever he hears, he will speak and he will disclose to you what is to come. So that seems to, if he has...
I'll send you, where is it? I'm looking at it real quick. He's talking about, is it 26?
But there again, when you're reading that, it says it will. The Greek says it, doesn't say he. The in the English, most of the translations have he, except the concordant literal.
Yeah. That's kind
of
how
can have it. How can an it have the initiative?
Yeah.
Well, the spirit of the on the part of the of Jesus. Jesus is the one, but he had to move away. He says, if Jesus had always stayed with the disciples, anything that come to their mind or a question, what do you say about this? What do you say about what that? No individual
could be everywhere.
Wrestling with he would, and also he has somewhat of authority over them. He wants to get himself out of their presence and let them wrestle with the questions. Because that's as long as we have the authority figure, we're dependent.
You can't. Not everybody can get to him. Need the spirit to be able to.
Sure. Good.
So functionally, we're talking about the same thing.
The Holy Spirit is repeatedly called a parakletos. Right. That's a comforter, someone who comes and assists to your side to assist you when you need help. Right. And Jesus himself in 1 John 2:1 is called a parakletos. I am writing this to you, my children, so that you will not sin. But if one does sin, we have someone who pleads with the Father on our behalf, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. So,
and he will convince the world.
Convince, that means to persuade.
Yeah.
And persuasion is a process. He uses words. It's to persuade.
You can say that, and I'm not arguing with that. You can also say it's a person who persuades.
Why couldn't it be the same person?
Well,
only
it could
a different
be.
Form.
It could be, except that Jesus said it's another one. It's a different one.
Well, I think
it's another one. He said that because he's in a different form then.
I think
Wouldn't
he's accommodating think? their lack of understanding, because if he wanted to know them to know that somebody, some creature or some person or some. He kind of personified Jesus in a way, personified it, but he talks about it rather than a person.
Yeah, and I explained why the it's there. Jesus described the work of the Holy Spirit as guiding, speaking, hearing, disclosing, and glorifying. That's John 16. The Holy Spirit also teaches us, reminds us, that's John 14:26. He dwells in us, John 14:17. He testifies, John 15:24-26. And he convicts, John 16:8.
Let me ask another question. We get over to John 17. And Jesus says, the Father has come, glorify thy Son, that the Son may glorify thee. Was that the Holy Spirit, another entity doing this? Or was the Father doing this for the Son? I don't think we need...
He was speaking
directly to the Father, wasn't he?
He was praying to the Father.
And where was it? Where was this Holy Spirit entity? It's not there.
Well, but that doesn't mean it can't
it
be
there.
Yeah. Does it need it?
I know, but it wasn't mentioned. It didn't need to be mentioned.
No, it's not necessary. He could. I don't need to pray to the Father for you because the Father loves you himself. He doesn't need an intercessor.
But the one who's described as the intercessor is Jesus.
Yes.
And we're coming up on Romans 8:26.
Yeah.
So
when Jesus
the Spirit intercedes for us.
Yeah. When Jesus was about to finish his work on this earth, he told his disciples he was going to send another helper, one similar to himself. He would send one who would continue to do his work and would be as a representative, but more than that, one who would be able to be near them no matter where they traveled or worked. And there's a whole bunch of verses. Let's just look at some of them. 14:26. The Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and make you remember all that I have told you. Then 15:26. The Helper will come, the Spirit who reveals the truth about God and who comes from the Father. We've already looked at that verse. Then Acts 15:28. What do we do with this? The Holy Spirit and we have agreed not to put any other burden on you besides these necessary rules. And this is the end of the first general conference. So it sounds like the Holy Spirit is making some choices. He's participating with them in this general conference.
But you know that the Holy Spirit always has come when Jesus wasn't there.
No. No, Jesus breathed on them and said, no, Jesus, the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, but when he's talking, why would, if that's true, why would he say, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit if it was already there?
But there are at least two times in Jesus was here as a person that the Holy Spirit descended upon him. What's that? And the Father's name, the Father spoke, the Holy Spirit descended, and Jesus was there. And the people are hearing a voice, they're seeing something like this.
Now, is that the baptism?
That's at the baptism, and it's also at the in the court of the temple on the last day when he was in last day of Jerusalem, Tuesday of...
Just before.
So you're making a proof there that we've got three separate things.
They're specifically mentioned.
I think you're being kind of materialistic.
No, you can call it what you like.
Well, I am. I'm calling it a materialistic idea. God is omnipotent. He can.
God. All three members of the Godhead are omnipotent.
All three members.
We do not know how we ought to pray. The Spirit Himself pleads with God for us and groans that words cannot express. And God, who sees into our hearts, knows what the thought of the Spirit is, because the Spirit pleads with God on behalf of His people in accordance with His will.
I have no problem with that. Absolutely.
Okay. And we've already looked at 1 Corinthians 12:11. Look at 1 Timothy 4:1. The Spirit says clearly that some people will abandon the faith in later times. They will obey lying spirits and follow the teachings of demons, such things as are spread and so forth. So one of the things that the Holy Spirit does is to teach and guide. So in all these verses, we have the following description of what the Holy Spirit does. The Holy Spirit will teach us everything, remind us of what Jesus has told us. The Holy Spirit will reveal the truth about God. He will speak the truth about Jesus. So He cooperates with Christians in their work on this earth. The Holy Spirit works with our prayers to present them in the most appropriate wording before the Father. More than that, the Holy Spirit gives gifts, talents to each person. He warns us about lying spirits and the teachings of demons that will come at the end of this world's history. So that's my very brief summary of those verses. Consider some additional aspects of the work of the Holy Spirit. If you look at Romans 8:14-16, let's see, then I can make it bigger. Those who are led by God's Spirit are God's children. For the Spirit that God has given you does not make you slaves and cause you to be afraid. Instead, the Spirit makes you God's children, and by the Spirit's power, we cry out to God, Father, my Father. God's Spirit joins Himself to our spirits to declare what we are, that we are God's children. And then dropping down to verse 27, God, who sees into our hearts, knows what the thoughts of the Spirit is, because the Spirit pleads with God on behalf of His people.
So I guess we have a spirit too. That's interesting.
Yeah, we do.
And so does God.
Could it be an evil spirit or a spirit of truth?
Well, it sounded like that the Holy Spirit can join with our spirit. Mm-hmm. So our spirit has, we have a spirit also. But we don't divide ourselves up into three or two categories, do we?
No, we don't.
But it works the same.
Well, we're
trying to limit God to our human
capability.
No,
I didn't say anything about God. I'm just trying to make an observation. Okay. That Ellen White said that God's Spirit will unite with our spirit. So we have a spirit too.
Well, the Bible says that. It's not Ellen White.
She says it too, but the Bible says it.
In Hebrews 4, it says the Word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword, dividing asunder to soul and spirit, able to of joints and marrow, and able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. So there's a parallel. There are parallel thoughts there. The soul is likened to the joints that move, and the spirit is likened to the life of the bone. And then the thoughts are likened to the soul, the activity. The spirit is likened to the intentions. In other words, where those thoughts are coming, what's driving those thoughts? Why? What's the source of that thought? So when we do things, there is something that activates us, and it might be, as Jim said, an evil spirit or or a good spirit. When disciples said, can we call down fire from heaven and destroy these people, Jesus rebuked them and said, you don't know what spirit you are of, because the Son of Man came to not to destroy life, but to save it. Mm-hmm. So they had their reasons for doing that. Elijah did it, so why shouldn't we do it? But
whatever,
they were activated by the wrong spirit.
Whatever spirit it is, though, whether it's God's or Satan's spirit, what he just read there, it unites with our spirit.
Right.
Here's another
verse. So that we can do the things.
In harmony, though, at John 17.
Our intentions are the same.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Romans 15, verse 30. I urge you, brothers and sisters, by our Lord Jesus Christ, and by the love that the Spirit gives, join me in praying fervently to God for me. That's Paul, of course, as he understands that he's facing some real challenges ahead of him. 1 Corinthians 2, verse 10. But it was to us that God made known his secret by means of his Spirit. The Spirit searches everything, even the hidden depths of God's purposes. Acts 8, verse 29, the Holy Spirit said to Philip, go over to that carriage and stay close to it. Philip ran over and heard him reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. He asked him, do you understand what you're reading? So is that a person who has the ability to speak and act in that kind of way?
It's Jesus.
Well, then why does it say spirit if it really is talking about Jesus?
Well, there's a lot of places where they use spirit and Jesus interchangeably. So I can use it interchangeably.
Well, back to John 6:63. The words he has spoken are spirit and life. It's that succinct.
Yeah. Of course, the challenge that we're facing with here, and we have lots of experiences already with it, is that the word spirit, like the word love, for example, can have lots of different meanings. And that's the challenge we're dealing with. Here's another example, Acts 10. Remember the story of Peter being called to go and see, to go to Cornelius' place. Peter was still trying to understand what the vision meant when the Spirit said, he's speaking now, listen, three men are here looking for you, so get ready to go. God's Spirit is speaking. And one other place, I'll show you. So they left disagreeing among themselves. This is, remember, Paul was asked for permission to go and make a presentation to the Sanhedrin there in Jerusalem. And Paul had left, after Paul had said this one thing, how well the Holy Spirit spoke through the prophet Isaiah to your ancestors for you, for he said, go and say to this people, you will listen and listen, but not understand, you will look and look, but not see, because this people's minds are dull and they have stopped up their ears and closed their eyes, otherwise their eyes would see, their ears would hear, their minds would understand, and they would turn to me, says God, and I would heal them. He's quoting from Isaiah, who says that those words are God, and are from God, and Paul says it's from the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit guides us, God's children. He encourages us to think of the Father as our Father, even as Daddy. Furthermore, the Holy Spirit knows the secrets of God. He searches out everything, even the hidden depths of God's purposes. The Holy Spirit gave specific directions to Philip to go to a certain carriage and speak to the one who was traveling back to Ethiopia. He told Peter to go with the people whom he had sent, even though they were Gentiles, in order to carry the gospel to Cornelius. Some years later, when under arrest in Jerusalem, Paul quoted the Holy Spirit as speaking through the prophet Isaiah. Do these actions described in Scripture suggest an impersonal force, a mere wind or fire, or are they clearly descriptions of an intelligent being? So if you want to say that that's always a reference to the Father or to Jesus, it has to be something that's an intelligent being. I think there's any
which
way
they are.
You can't get out away from that.
Which anyway. They are.
So Ephesians 4, verse 30, we've looked at this once before. Do not make God's Holy Spirit sad, for the Spirit is God's mark of ownership, God's seal on you, a guarantee that the day will come when God will set you free. I don't know how many of these verses we need to read. Notice that the distinctive characteristics of personality that are used in these verses to describe the Holy Spirit. He has understanding, he has feelings, he makes choices, he has a will. Only a personal being could be grieved. Personal beings can be deceived and lied to. Personal beings have the ability to think and choose and the capacity to love. Thus, we are saying the Holy Spirit is self-conscious, self-knowing, self-willing, and self-determining. He is capable of loving. Ellen White describes it in these terms: the Holy Spirit has a personality. Also, he could not bear witness to our...
Elsie, you said also.
I'm sorry. Else, he could not bear witness to our spirits and with our spirits that we are the children of God. He must also be a divine person, else he could not search out the secrets which lie hidden in the mind of God. That's the easiest place to find that is Evangelism 6:17, paragraph 1. So, could we have a close working relationship with the Holy Spirit if he were merely an impartial force, a wind or fire? So tell me what you think the Holy Spirit is.
Jesus.
So Jesus is saying, I will send him? What is he talking about
himself? If you take all those texts, take out Holy Spirit and put Jesus there,
you're changing the meaning.
No.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are changing the meaning, and that's my point. If Jesus came, if you used Jesus' name instead of Holy Spirit, you wouldn't know that he was invisible. Remember, the Spirit comes like the wind. You can't see him. Mm-hmm. But it's still Jesus.
Okay, what you're saying is that the Holy Spirit behaves and acts and thinks exactly like Jesus. I don't have any problem with that at all.
Well, I don't have any problem at all. You don't even have to prove it to me because I think they're the same thing.
Well,
so if they're the same thing, you don't have to prove it.
It's the character.
They are doing
the same character.
Same character, same everything. It's just that you can't see him.
It's true that as we think about Jesus Christ, it's easy for us to imagine him as a human being because of his time on this earth. We often associate the Father with Jesus Christ and think of him also as a personal being. But the Holy Spirit is often pictured in ways that are a little bit harder for us to wrap our minds around, okay? But we've already looked at Acts 15:28. The Holy Spirit met with the First General Conference Committee, and they said that he agreed with them. So this is the conclusion from that very important perhaps First General Conference meeting in Jerusalem, held in Jerusalem. What do you think James had in mind? What do you think he thought when he said it seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us? What did James think he was talking about?
Talking about Jesus.
You don't have any evidence for that?
Sure I do. It's what I believe. The Holy Spirit is Jesus. There's only one God. You're talking about three gods here. I just don't agree with that.
Jesus said the Holy Spirit would take of mine and give it to you. So it's talking about two distinct individuals. He's not saying, I'm going to go away and I'm just going to come back and
today
and
even
give these
actors
things.
Talk about the people that they portray as a different person. Yep. So the same concept can happen there.
Mm. That's a...
No, you just haven't thought about it before.
Oh yes, I thought about it.
No, not what I just said.
I've rejected it.
Not what you said.
If the Holy Spirit were nothing more than an impersonal force, there's no way that he could have an intelligent capacity to cooperate with a group in making such a choice. So,
well, I don't see any problem with that when he's Jesus. Mm-hmm. That's what you're not telling me that he isn't Jesus.
Why would Jesus say it's another one different from
just
me?
Just what I said. He's coming in a different form. He isn't going to say, I'm going to come. He's going to say the Holy Spirit's going to come because it's going to be okay. Him in a different form.
So what's wrong with it being another person? There's nothing.
Hear me, O Israel.
Nothing wrong.
Your God is one God, one in number.
The problem is that Jesus...
It's in the Old Testament.
is not omnipresent. He's in heaven and he has a human body at this point. So
what?
He could not be here
except through the Holy Spirit.
He got a spiritual body, 1 Corinthians 15. You die a physical body, he says, and then you're raised a spiritual body. So that spiritual body can disseminate to all finite creatures.
You're assuming mechanics of that spiritual body is.
Well, he could go through the doors there. Remember,
yeah, but that doesn't mean omnipresence. He can't be with.
Well, if it's a wind, it can go wherever it wants, or it's radio waves or whatever.
So why does it say, go then to all peoples everywhere and make them my disciples, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit? Three names.
They would understand all three of them, all three forms, because these three forms are important to explain why all-covering God that knows everything, that knows every molecule in the whole universe, what it's doing, mm-hmm. comes in different forms, so that a form like the sun, so he could walk with men. Mm-hmm. These are ideas that are very huge.
Okay.
And that's what they're saying when he says, baptize him in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Ellen White says, this is Evangelism, page 615, there are three living persons of the heavenly trio, and the name of these three great powers, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, those who receive Christ by living faith are baptized, and these powers will cooperate with the obedient subjects of heaven in their efforts to live the new life in Christ. I think that's pretty clear.
So if I say I don't agree with her on that, am I from the devil?
No, but you're not with Ellen White.
Well, do you have to be 100% with somebody to be with her?
My approach to that would be simply, if God has revealed something, I want to have my ideas as close to the revealed will of God as possible, and not something
separate.
If God
has revealed something.
Okay,
so when do you make that decision when he has?
I just read to you.
So anything she writes is gospel truth. She doesn't do anything wrong.
Well, I mean, that's a separate issue if you want to discuss
it. No, it's not, because you're just saying that anything she writes has got to be perfect, and you're using that statement. And you're saying that anything she writes
and
is going to be true.
You're choosing to say that you have greater authority than Ellen White. And
no,
I disagree with that.
I'm just saying.
I just disagree with that.
I'm just saying that one statement I don't agree with her on.
Yeah. So let's talk about truth. Jim was asking us to talk about truth. Jesus answered him, I am the way. This is Jesus talking to Philip, I believe it was. Thomas. Okay, it was Thomas. Jesus answered him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. John 14, verse 6. No one goes to the Father except by me. So what does he mean by saying, I am the truth? What did Jesus mean when he said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life? How does that relate to his later expression in John 17:17, where he says, dedicate them to yourself? In his prayer, he's talking to God. Dedicate them to yourself by means of the truth. Your word is truth. And we know that in John repeatedly, the word is used to refer to Christ. Now, we've got a bit of a problem. We've had a lot of problem with semantics in these lessons, and we're going to have more. Now, because of our tendency to follow Greek philosophy, in our Western ways of thinking, we think of truth more as propositions that can be proven scientifically somehow or other, and so forth. That's not the way the Hebrews tended to think of things. They believed that truth can best be represented by a person. We've already
John 17, I have accomplished the work you gave me to do. I've made known your character. That's a revelation. That's a part of the message, the word. Persuasion.
So look at John 15, verse 26. The Helper will come, the Spirit who reveals the truth about God and who comes from the Father. And then at John 16:13. Take me just a second and I'll go there. When, however, the Spirit comes, now if Jesus were talking about himself, why would he say, when the Spirit comes? Who reveals the truth about God, he will lead you into all truth. He will not speak on his own authority, but will speak of what he hears and will tell you of things to come. So, and my point, in the, what we really want to say here is that one of the most important aspects of the Holy Spirit is that he reveals the truth about God. There are a few things more important to us at this point in history than to understand the truth about God. That is an essential element in understanding the great controversy. So, going back to the Old Testament, look at Deuteronomy 32, verse 4. The Lord is your mighty defender, perfect and just in all his ways. Your God is faithful and true. He does what is right and fair. Okay? So now if we take a parallel passage in Psalm 31, I place myself in your care. You will save me, Lord. You are a faithful God. So we have God here taking care of people. And these verses, God is described as a God of all truth. So if the Spirit is a part of the Godhead, he should be the Spirit of truth. So what do we read? He is the Spirit who reveals the truth about God that we just read. If the Spirit is a part of the Godhead, he should be the Spirit of truth. So in what sense is Jesus the truth? Well, Jesus is the truth in the sense that virtually any question that we might ask about God and his kingdom can be answered by looking at the life and death of Jesus. Thus he was and is the truth about God.
And then you got John 18:37. He's talking to Pilate, and he says, his mission was to reveal the truth, mm-hmm. or bear witness to the truth, I think it is. And the next verse, it basically is, if you don't have an affinity for truth, it really has no impact on you. If you don't have an appreciation for truth,
There's...
This I came into the world to testify to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice. And Pilate said to him, what is truth?
Yeah. And the truth will set you free.
But truth is not just something that came into being after God. It's part
Always
of
been.
His being. It's part of his
well,
character.
He is.
Right. So he's the source of all truth.
What would be wrong with thinking of the Holy Spirit merely as a divine force, a wind or fire? Well, if he is a divine person, and we think of him as an impersonal influence, we are robbing a divine person of the deference, honor, and love that is his due. Now that's Leroy Froom, The Coming of the Comforter. Ellen White says, if we think of the Holy Spirit only as a mysterious divine power, our thoughts will be, how can I have more? I'm sorry, this is not Ellen White. This is our Bible study guide, I believe. Yeah,
yes.
Bible study guide. If we think of the Holy Spirit only as a mysterious divine power, our thoughts will be, how can I have more of the Holy Spirit? But if we think of the Holy Spirit as a divine person, we will ask, how can the Holy Spirit have more of me? The decisive point is, do you want to possess the Holy Spirit or do you want the Holy Spirit to possess you? Do you resist his influence or are you willing to follow him in joyful obedience?
What do you mean by possessed you? What does that mean?
That means he's going to, he doesn't take over, he doesn't control you, he just guides you.
The fruit of the Spirit is self-control. Mm-hmm. So,
love, joy, peace, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance, or self-control.
Self-control, that means, it implies that nothing else is doing the controlling, it is you. You've made a decision for or against, and there's a consequence to your decision. good or bad.
We can choose to walk after the spirit or after the flesh.
Yeah.
So that's where self-control, the will comes in. But the spirit, we can walk after the spirit as he guides us.
And, right.
And so do you want to use the spirit according to your plans, or do you rely on him so that he can enable you to become more like Jesus Christ and do what he has in mind for you? Do you take seriously the fact that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God? And are you willing to glorify God with how you live? So that's the next question. Now let's look at some of the words from Paul. Romans 5, verse 5, "This hope does not disappoint us, for God has poured out his love into our hearts by means of the Holy Spirit, who is God's gift to us." What does that mean? In Ephesians 2, 18 and 19, "It is through Christ that all of us, Jews and Gentiles, are able to come in the one Spirit into the presence of the Father. So then you Gentiles are not foreigners or strangers any longer. You are now fellow citizens with God's people and members of the family of God." In essence, he's trying to say, he's making an appeal to Christians to love one another, and he suggests that the Holy Spirit is the one who gives us that capacity to become loving members of God's family.
And he expounds on that in the first part of chapter 4.
Yeah.
We don't have time to go in there necessarily.
Yeah. Do you think we could look forward to giving the Holy Spirit a big hug when we get to heaven?
No. I know Richard Neese thought that was a good idea, but I don't.
I think it's a wonderful idea.
I don't think it's gonna. I think it's a fantasy. We might have, but it's not necessary, surely.
Ellen White says, "We cannot use the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is to use us." That's based on Philippians 2:13. "God is always at work in you to make you willing and able to obey his own purpose." Ellen White made some very striking statements about the work of the Holy Spirit to which we should pay attention. Here's one. First one I'm reading you is from, hold on, let me just say, Desire of Ages 671. It says, "Sin could be resisted and overcome only through the mighty agency of the third person of the Godhead." The third person of the Godhead, who would come with no modified energy, but in the fullness of divine power. It is the Spirit that makes effectual what has been wrought out by the world's Redeemer. It is by the Spirit that the heart is made pure. Through the Spirit, the believer becomes a partaker of the divine nature. Christ has given his Spirit as a divine power to overcome all hereditary and cultivated tendencies to evil, and to impress his own character upon his church. Of the Spirit, Jesus said, "He shall glorify me." The Savior came to glorify the Father by the demonstration of his love, so that the Spirit was to glorify Christ by revealing his grace to the world. The very image of God is to be reproduced in humanity. The honor of God, the honor of Christ, is involved in the perfection of the character of his people. Desire of Ages 671. And another place, "We cannot use the Holy Spirit. The Spirit is to use us. Through the Spirit, God works in his people to will and to do of his good pleasure," Philippians 2:13. "But many will not submit to this. They want to manage themselves. This is why they do not receive the heavenly gift. Only to those who wait humbly upon God, who watch for his guidance and grace, is the Spirit given. The power of God awaits their demand and reception. This promised blessing, claimed by faith, brings all other blessings in its train. It is given according to the riches of the grace of Christ, and he is ready to supply every soul according to the capacity to receive." So that's pages 672. Well, so let's talk about comparisons here. Do any of us have any doubts about the personality of the Father?
I don't think you need to make the Father a person. That implies finiteness. We're talking about the infinite one, mm-hmm. who is the energy that without
a limit. We're saying that a person is one who has ability to think, has the ability to choose, has the ability to speak and to make his will known.
Well, on that definition, I would not have a problem.
Okay.
Because if we're created in God's image or the image, and the infinite one has choice. And however, does the infinite one kill? He's the source of life. And when Jesus, he conquered.
It depends on whether you're talking about the first death or the second death.
I don't think there's enough instances in the Bible where it says that all intelligent creatures are going to die, but it doesn't say God's killing them.
No,
I didn't mean to say all intelligent. I mean all those that are not in harmony with the Creator are going to die.
Jesus says, though, that we should fear God, who can destroy both body and soul in hell. So it implies that he has the power over our lives.
Mm-hmm. Does that win us over?
Well, I'm not implying.
Well, I mean, you know that,
that isn't. That's just warning us about what is obvious, I think, to any of us who respect and honor God, that he's our Creator, and he, as Job said, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Yeah.
Well, Job, as great as Job is, that doesn't mean he understood everything.
No.
So let's not put that, just like the rest of the guys.
So do we have any problems with the personality of the Son?
No.
If not, why should we question the personality and personhood of the Holy Spirit when he is described in the Bible as doing all those same things? Do we want to deny the loving, caring, comforting presence of the third person of the Godhead?
Well, one thing has happened is with taking that position, you've shut off an awful high percentage of the world's intelligent creatures, obviously the Jews and the Muslims, and you have a hard time communicating, implying that there's another...
They don't admit that even Jesus is...
I agree with
it. Divine,
yeah,
so
that's true.
I don't think that's a stretch. And again, I would repeat, we need to realize that the Holy Spirit, who is as much a person as God is a person, is walking through these grounds. That's Evangelism 6:16, paragraph 5. So, out there, you have a choice. You've heard our different suggestions here. Do you accept the personality and the personhood of the Holy Spirit? So what are the characteristics of a person? What gives an individual personality? Are we prepared to let the Holy Spirit speak to us through his word as he testifies to the work of Jesus as recorded in the Gospels? It is his special work, the Bible tells us, to help us understand the life, ministry, and death of Jesus Christ. We do not need to worry about having access to the Holy Spirit. Wherever we may go and under whatever circumstances we may find ourselves, he is there. Is prepared to guide, counsel, encourage, strengthen, and inspire us with hope. Let's review. There are three basics of personality which are essential in all our, in our understanding of the Holy Spirit. One, he has a mind that thinks and reasons. Two, he has a will that he exercises by correctly representing the Father and the Son. And three, he is able to speak what he thinks and communicate to human beings. It was thus that he brought to us the Holy Scriptures. We will speak more about how he communicates and has communicated in our next lesson. So, it is true that we often equate personhood with visibility, and that's one of the things that we've struggled with here. It is much harder for us to imagine a person who is invisible. Some of his characteristics, such as his omnipresence, are mysterious to us. Infinite things are difficult for the human mind to comprehend. I mean, how do we deal with it might be possible for us to think of people living forever, going on, but back, infinity back past, I don't know, maybe that's easier for some of the rest of you, but I find that, you know, I believe it. The Bible says it, and I take it to be true, but to wrap my mind around it is pretty difficult. Remember that just because we may not fully understand something does not mean that it does not exist. How many details of biology, chemistry and physics do we not fully understand? Gordon, you've studied all these things and you know all about them, right?
Absolutely not.
Jesus repeatedly described the Holy Spirit as comforter, helper, or guide. Sometimes we bring the Greek word right into English as parakletos or paraclete. For a bit more detail about what that word, you can go to, if you have want to get our handout, which is available online. It'll take you straight to the definitions from one of the Bible dictionaries. In ancient times, someone who was called into court to be accused was allowed to have a parakletos. That person might help the accused physically, mentally, emotionally, and or psychologically. In addition to food, blankets, and or water, that person might provide legal aid. There is no situation that we could face in which the Holy Spirit would not be a present help. So what do we mean when we say the Holy Spirit has a mind and a will? So how does that work? We're not sure. Well, clearly the mind is the center of thought. It is there that we reason and we have a conscience and we make decisions. The Bible tells us that we may have the mind of Christ. Look at Philippians. I mean, these are verses that hopefully we're very familiar with. Look at Philippians 2:5. This is that fantastic passage about Jesus. The attitude you should have is the one that Christ Jesus had. He always had the nature of God, but he did not think that by force he should try to remain equal with God. Instead of this, of his own free will, he gave up all he had and took the nature of a servant. He became like a human being and appeared in human likeness. He was humble and walked the path of obedience all the way to death, his death on the cross. For this reason, God raised him to the highest place above and gave him the name that is greater than any other name. And so in honor of the name of Jesus, all beings in heaven, on earth, and in the world below will fall on their knees and all will openly proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. And 1 Corinthians 2, verse 16, as the scripture says, who knows the mind of the Lord? Who is able to give him advice? We, however, have the mind of Christ. And remember that we've already suggested that the Holy Spirit understands the secret things of God. Look at Romans 12, verse 16. Have the same concern for everyone. Do not be proud, but accept humble duties. Do not think of yourselves as wise. So we've seen that God, who was humble, I mean, look at the experience of Jesus. He comes down to this earth. He not only agrees to live as a human being, he agrees to die the death of a traitor, of a terrible criminal. And so we should certainly be willing to be humble too. 2 Corinthians 13, verse 3 says, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Why do you think those three are separated out? Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will help us in living that way with our fellow believers. So just as the ability to think is a defining characteristic of the personhood, so is the ability to choose or to have a will or a free will. Animals have minds, but they do not have wills or choices. God created us with that capacity which he did not give to animals. And here's another comment from, give me just a second here.
Education 289.
Education page 289. We're trying to make the font larger so it's easier to read, and then I have to go down a long ways. The will is the governing power in the nature of man, the power of decision or choice. Every human being possessed of reason has power to choose the right. In every experience of life, God's word to us is, choose you this day whom you will serve. Everyone may place his will on the side of the will of God, may choose to obey him, and by thus linking himself with divine agencies, he may stand where nothing can force him to do evil. Education, page 289. So, we are repeatedly told that the right exercise of the will, with the guidance of the Holy Spirit, will help us to develop God-like characters. Is that something we really want and need? The Holy Spirit is a separate, distinct personality. He thinks, reasons, makes decisions, and chooses. In our next lesson, we will see how he communicates. Along with the Father and the Son, he's an essential part of the Trinity. So, Gary, you've been talking a lot about this. What do you think Trinity means?
Trinity, mm-hmm. It's a study. It's a study of three forms of the same God. It explains how God, the infinite one, mm-hmm. can come down and walk with men. That was a hard thing for the Jews to understand, and I think that's why the apostles came up with the Trinity. Trinity is not in the Bible, of course.
Mm-hmm. But the word is not in the Bible.
Yeah, the word is not in the Bible. Yeah. But these are three forms of God that are very important to understand that.
Okay. So what practical things could we do to hear the voice of God speaking through the Holy Spirit as we read God's Word? The more not familiar...
Seek, what? Not to seek our own will, okay. and walk in our own ways. Uh-huh. We need to seek the will of the Father as Jesus did.
So let's talk about that for a second. It would be my understanding, and we're running out of time here, but it would be my understanding that when we open the Word of God, or when we pray, when we seek to commune with God, either through reading His Word or praying, we are opening our minds to the Holy Spirit and giving Him an opportunity to influence us, to change us, to transform us, really. The more familiar we are with the Bible and its ways of thinking and talking, the easier it will be for us to understand the speech of the Holy Spirit. He is a powerful ally in overcoming sin and enabling us to live joyful and abundant Christians. Shouldn't each one of us will, desire, and choose to cooperate in every possible way with the Holy Spirit? That's our challenge we want to leave with you. Our kind and wonderful Father, we understand that these expressions of divinity and their various forms as presented in Scripture are challenging, that there are different ways to understand them. Help us to draw as near as we can to you so that we may accept your guidance and understanding them correctly is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.